Ladies and gentlemen, I wish to take off from where Ambassador Talwij Ahmed left, and he made two very important points with regard to ISIS in particular and terrorism in general. When he said that it is not possible to defeat an organization like ISIS, and he gave the example of Al-Qaeda. This example can be given for many other terrorist groups and insurgent groups in history. It's true because it is not based on the force of arms alone. Terrorist movements are founded on ideas, and battle of ideas can't be fought with guns and drones. They have to be fought at the ideational level. That's number one. The second is that irrespective of what the people say, there are good people in all countries. But the fact of the matter is that there has been a sectarian divide, very serious sectarian divide. And the countries, various countries, have made use of it for their own purposes. And of course, the real sufferers are the people. You are all well aware of why the IS rose, what was behind IS's quick success and all that. A point which my Iraqi colleague just made about the Iraqi army abandoning its weapons and leaving when there were 60, 70,000 people in Mosul, for example. I think a lesson for every country must be that the armies cannot become sectarian armies. Armies cannot become armies of political parties. Armies have to be national armies. And there is a contrast here. Contrasted with Syria, for example. Most of the conscripts, at least more than 60% of the conscripts or 70% of the conscripts happen to be Sunnis. And they still continue to be with the regime. Large number of people have lost their lives. Many of them have been maimed. But still there are people who are coming to fight on the side of the government, despite so much of religious, sectarian divide within the country. So what had happened is that Iraqi army was demobilized wholescale. After the American misadventure, I would call it, in Iraq. And all the officers were demobilized, the soldiers were demobilized. And then they tried to create an army by giving them uniforms and thinking that this has become a professional army. It wasn't. Reports were that even before ISIS came in, the people used to leave their posts and give some bribes to their senior officers or NCOs to remain away from the place of posting. And the postings were given to people, transfers were made based on monetary considerations. If that was the state of the armed forces, and if the leadership wasn't there, if inexperienced leadership was there, you don't expect very much from an army. It is not the numbers that fight, it's the morale and the command control that goes with it, that makes a unit or a formation or an army professional. That was aside. Let me just say that, let me focus on two, three things because of positive time. Why did IS gain such swift victories in the military field? That is one. Secondly, how is IS different from Al-Qaeda, for example? What are its strengths and weaknesses? And a brief bit about the oil business, and lastly, what we can do. When I say what we can do, I do not mean in the classical sense defeat it as such, because defeat is an idea, it's a long-term thing, and many other measures would be. But on the military field, you got to weaken it, but more fundamentally, I think you got to get them out of this area that they are occupying. Because this area is fundamental to their existence and to their appeal, because of which large number of people from various countries are joining it. How did they win these swift military victories? They were very simple tactical lessons. It wasn't strong to begin with in June 2014 when it took over Mosul. That time the number of foreign fighters were speculated at 10,000 or 20,000. 30,000 numbers, 30,000 came much later. And of all, a maximum number of 20 or 30,000 would have been the homegrown basic jihadis over there. So taking a strength of about 50,000, how come they carved out a country bigger than the size of England, UK, let's say, bigger than many states in India? How did they do that? Of course, they occupied, they filled that vacuum that was created because of poor governance, because of the societal chasms, differences that were exist. They did make use of that. They also made use of the sectarian clashes, wherein this idea that had been floated a couple of years back and continued, Shia crescent, rise of Iran, and the Muslim victimhood, that the whole world is against them. In this kind of an environment, I think ISIS just stepped into this kind of an environment. And then, of course, exclusion of the Sunnis. I mean, our Iraqi guest has inside view, but let me have an objective view from outside. Objective view was that Sunnis were discriminated, and that Nuri al-Maliki wasn't a saint at all. And because of which, the Sawa movement, which Abbas Talmizi had mentioned, who had helped in controlling Zarqawi's bands, all those people became disenfranchised. They felt let down. The people didn't get jobs. They did not get the money that they deserved. And as a result of which, what happened is, large number of Sunnis, particularly Naqshbandis, and the ex-Baathists and ex-soldiers joined ISIS. So they had a leadership. They had a committed cadre. They had a cadre which wanted to take revenge from the West for whatever past sins that had been done. They want to take revenge against Shias. So this was the ready band of people. And ranged against them were a dissipated, corrupt, inexperienced military officers commanding a horde of people. So this was a mismatch over there. And so what was the tactics like? Very simple tactics. Simultaneous, sudden, multi-directional, but well-coordinated attacks. They will appear at one place and simultaneously appear at two other places. As a result of which, the army command control system really could not cope up. They did not know what was happening where. And other thing that they did was, they move in with the trucks and cars laden with explosives, blast them off to wear off the first line of defense, follow it up with vehicle-mounted, MMG-mounted, personnel, and who will shoot at random or all sides. So as a result of which, they created that aura of shock and awe. So the shock and awe, and thereafter follow it up with improvised explosive devices, IEDs, planted at strategic places, so that even when more people come, more people can be killed. The brutality, the assassinations and beheadings and all they did, that was also for effect, of course, because it was for effect. But that, please understand, last year, one of the think tanks carried out a study. Out of 900 messages in a month that ISIS put out, 52% were on quality of life that ISIS was offering. 46% were on the military victories that they had, and only 2% were about the brutality. But initially, brutality was shown, primarily because they wanted to show themselves as a potent force. So this is how it was done. So, what they also did was that there were certain ungovernable spaces in Syria because of the civil war. The writ of the government didn't lodge. Basically, two fighting forces were there with the Syrian regime. That was the 4 Armored Division and the Presidential Guard. And since large number of jihadi groups have cropped up in Syria, these two forces had to rush from place one to place two. As a result of which, the Syrian army was fatigued. And obviously, it gave in at some stage when it started losing territory and it couldn't respond. So they had to have somebody like Colonel Hassan all of a sudden becoming a hero, because of which a female minister had to resign because she hugged him, and because he was such a big hero that anywhere there was a crisis, he was sent there and he restored the situation. So that was a side effect that a poor lady minister had to resign because of that. Now, so here, as a result of which, what happened is that in northeastern Syria, a lot of void was created, and they came and filled up this void. YPG, if you followed up how the situation in Syria has developed, the People's Protection Units, they were sitting quiet initially. They did not take sides either with the jihadis or the rebels, let us say, who were supported by Saudi Arabia, Qatar, UAE, Turkey, and God knows who all. They did not take sides with them, and they did not take sides with Bashar al-Assad for two reasons. One reason, they weren't sure which way the wind would blow. Second, they wanted to preserve their strength so that they can throw in the dice when the situation was right. And I think they've been proved right, because they've expanded their Rojavas, the cantons, and they are probably the best off presently. I'll be showing you a slide subsequently when I'll show you that in the year 2015, how much of territory has been lost by whom. And that will give you an idea as to how the Kurdish people have won and others have lost comparatively. Now, after this, let me just show this. Another point that the ambassador had made was that you can't defeat it because you can go anywhere else. Just let me just show you this slide. In the last year, 2015, it doesn't have details about Indonesia, etc., where recently bombings have taken place. But some of the bombings that have taken place in last year, a large number of them, the area has expanded, and it has gone to Europe. It can go anywhere today. They are claiming it in Bangladesh. It need not necessarily be ISIS itself which is carrying out these attacks. Let me be very careful about it. But any jihadi carrying out this kind of an attack and claiming it in the name of ISIS serves the purpose of both IS, because it gives it the sense of potency, and it gives more credibility to this jihadi, because the name of ISIS draws better attention. So it may not be directly taking orders from there, directly taking money from there, may not be under direct control of that. Because as far as ISIS is concerned, it has only so far authorized 9 countries where they have, including Nigeria, Algeria, Pakistan, Afghanistan, etc., 9 of them where they said they have their affiliates or branches, so to say. All others, everywhere else, people are claiming it, but they need not necessarily be either in contact with IS or under control of ISIS. But the very fact that lone wolf attacks can also take place in the name of ISIS, it gives that sense of potential to ISIS. So the very fact that they have expanded like this, and they have the potential to expand even more, simply means that you can dislocate from there. For example, a very suitable candidate where the ISIS leadership can move is Libya. Probably more ungovernable than even Iraq. They can probably go and shift there in case they are moved out from there. But we need to fix the problem here. And the problem that needs to be fixed is, what do you do with IS? Do we say that, okay, you can't defeat it, so you let it be? Let the borders be altered for permanently? Or do you want to do something to it? Do you want to remove it from power from these areas? They might remain a nuisance. They might remain an insurgent force, but they cannot remain a state, a proto-state presently, but can't be permitted to firm up as a state. Because if that happens, that will be the greatest victory of the non-state actors. That will be the greatest political victory. So therefore, question comes in, what objective do we set for this? If the whole world today, and let me also tell you that everything is not good with IS. I'll come down to their weaknesses and what we can do with them. The largest single achievement of ISIS, besides, of course, making this notion of caliphate attractive to large number of youth everywhere, the greatest single achievement of theirs is that they have managed to get everybody against them. They got state support, and our Professor Ayadin was, of course, saying tongue-in-cheek, but they are of course, documented things that MIT, the National Intelligence Organization of Turkey, they were transporting weapons and ammunition to ISIS, Jabhat al-Nusra and others, and their own prosecutors stopped them in Adana and other places And those prosecutors were removed and, you know, dismissed from service because MIT personnel were directly taking these drugs over there. So it was so blatant. As far as oil is concerned, let me just take you back to the time when Iraq was under sanctions. But from Kurdish areas, I've personally seen thousands of Turkish trucks lined up taking the cheap oil from Saddam Hussein's government. And they were every time claiming that they lost $45 billion because of sanctions on oil sanctions, etc., on Iraq. But they were doing it. Over here also, but the story of oil here is slightly different. Why it's different is that although Alomar and other two, three main fields in Syria and one near Mosul in Iraq were taken over by ISIS, but obviously they had problem with spare parts. They had problem with the number of engineers. Although they tried to run it as an oil corporation, they put out ads. They tried to hire the same people who were working over there before. And they offered higher salaries to engineers from outside. But obviously, there were restrictions. They were being able to get all the spares, and some people wanted to leave. In addition to that, the oil production, particularly in the Syrian fields, had been falling for a couple of years. Obviously, they have become less productive. So as a result of which, the oil that was going, it is true, whether Mr. Putin said or did not say, your photographs showed that there are hundreds of trucks again going and crossing into Turkey. Whether Turkey used them or Turkey was used, I don't know. This quality of oil was so good because it was basically being refined in rudimentary refineries over there. It was supposed to be a heavy kind of an oil, which was generally used for tractors, for running your generators, for things of that nature, and not a sweet crude or something like that. And it was locally refined. So now what has happened, however, that after Mr. Putin raised this valid question, that if you're claiming that they're making every month, they're making $30 to $50 million out of oil, and you know that, you can see it from the air that large number of truck convoys are going, why don't you bomb them? The initial excuse that was given is, we are not bombing the oil producing facilities because a legitimate government that comes in subsequently should not be deprived of the oil production over there. A funny kind of an argument, but argument all the same. And then who stopped them from bombing the trucks, for example? So it was for the first time when Mr. Putin started bombing the trucks that the allies also started bombing the trucks. So what has ISIS done to that? Previously, the trucks used to come to one place, take the oil and go away. Now, they have started stopping the trucks outside and issuing them serial numbers. Like you go in hospital and take those serial number for your doctor's appointment. So they start giving those serial numbers to the trucks and time written on that, that you can only come there at this particular time. So dispersal, common kind of a tactics that military vehicles do, for example, they disperse when under threat. So similarly here, dispersion was achieved by them, and they are still continuing with it. But the very fact that day before yesterday, it has come out in the press that the salary of all fighters had been reduced by 50%, shows that this destruction of oil facilities and trucks, etc., is now started hurting. So now, but all the same, much of this oil was not going outside. It was being consumed in the areas that were governed by ISIS itself. Or surprisingly, it was going to the Syrian armed forces, and it was going to all other terrorist organizations, including Jaish-e-Islam, Ahrar al-Sham, Zibat al-Nusra, and Free Syrian Army. Each one of them was buying over there. If you read the reports on Syrian war economy, you'll find that a generator set is producing electricity under one group and supplying electricity to its opponent in exchange for rice or something else. Well, that's war economy. Let me come down to ammunition, for example. The kind of battles that ISIS has been fighting, and indiscriminate firing and all that kind of thing, requires huge quantity of ammunition, particularly of MMGs and Klasnikovs and things like grenades, etc. They found a very fine system. They got hold of some people and said, can you supply ammunition to us? Where you buy is not our botheration. This is the money. only one condition, that you will do this business only for us. That means you will buy it from anywhere, buy it from Israelis for all we care, buy it from anywhere. Buy it and sell it to us, but you will not sell it to anybody else. Therefore, where did the ammunition start coming from? Ammunition started coming from Latakia, from Idlib, from Kirkuk, from Tikrit, from everywhere. And this was again a war economy at its best, wherein some people started making money out of supplying ammunition to ISIS, and some of the ammunition which was supplied by the Americans to their friends whom they were training over there got passed on to ISIS for money like this. So that's how. And so what they did was, however, the greater challenge was to make it reach the place of fighting, because the ISIS tactics primarily was concentrate at the point of decision, remain dispersed so that you don't become a big target, but concentrate. That's why vehicle mobility was very important. Move in Humvees, move in Toyotas, but concentrate at the point of decision, take the defenders by surprise. And ammunition has to reach there. Now, what are the documents which the Kurdish Peshmergas in Iraq captured last year? It was a beautiful description. A battle plan, and the ammunition trail. They formed what is called roving committees. Roving committees were in direct communication with the field commanders and with the ammunition depots, ammunition suppliers. Roaming committee will collect the demand, get it from there, and within 24 hours, any quantity of ammunition required anywhere will go. The administration, the rudimentary administration that they initially established, local walis or amirs, or local, governors, had quite a lot of freedom in running the administration. But there were three issues which were controlled centrally. One, oil. Second, military operations, including logistics. And third, the strategic propaganda. These three issues were controlled centrally, still continue to be controlled centrally. All other issues, they have of course tried to, in order to be accepted as a state, because they probably are also thinking that the world somehow ends up accepting the fait accompli, whatever you give it to them, be it Kosovo, be it South Ossetia or anything like that. As long as you create the fact and retain it for some time, the world ends up accepting it. So probably IS is working on the same line. And if that be so, then we need to identify what are their weaknesses. And should we accept this kind of situation becoming permanent? Well, I for one, personally would not like the situation to become permanent one, because this is a bad example for everybody else, everywhere in the world, for centuries to come. So they have to be removed from there. Their control over this area has to be removed totally. So therefore, what is the strategy that you must have? And the first step in this strategy should be your objective. How do you define the objective? If you define the objective like the Americans have been defining the roving kind of a objective in Afghanistan, for example, you can't define victory. You can't define destruction as an objective. Because destruction means today is not there, it's gone somewhere else, dispersed, can't be seen in great strength. Would you call it that as destruction? How do you count that every single insurgent has been killed? So that's not an objective. So objective could probably be, I'm just doing a loud thinking, objective could be remove ISIS control or areas of Syria and Iraq, presently occupied by them, or Syria and Iraq, and return this territory to the respective governments to re-establish the internationally recognized boundaries. This, or a refined version of this, would probably be an objective which can be measured, success of which can be measured. That is one. Secondly, longer it takes to resolve these issues and remove ISIS from this area. Please understand that the idea of caliphate is important, and it has taken roots primarily because they control the territory. If they're not controlling the territory, then the idea of caliphate itself wouldn't have caught on. So therefore, removing them from the territory is important. Longer they stay in territory, more the world opinion gets fatigued, and many people then start saying, oh, menu ki, I mean, how does it matter to me, let's accept it. When that kind of a thing happens, then it becomes a permanent kind of a thing. So therefore, speed is of essence. You've got to do it quickly. Thirdly, of course, there are a large number of problems because all the stakeholders involved in this have different motives, have different objectives of their own. But I think in the heart of arts, each one of them is afraid. Saudis are afraid of ISIS. Syria and Iraq, of course, is afraid. Even the French are afraid, and if you see the kind of reaction that they gave of these 8 jihadis going and doing so much of damage, I think they are mortally afraid. Americans themselves are afraid. Everybody is afraid because it's a phenomenon like this. It's not something that your conscious, your mind accepts something as normal. You don't consider it as normal. So obviously you'll be afraid of somebody moving around with a gun and killing people indiscriminately. You can't become a police state, security state. So therefore, we all have to agree to one thing, that today, the sideshows, remove Basrar, bring in Abadi, do this thing, all these should become secondary objectives to the one primary objective of removing ISIS from there. Can the people do it? Well, I think they can, but there are a lot of obstacles that have to be overcome and people have to negotiate, sit down together and all this, because this is a threat which I think which is, and ISIS has done us a great favor by getting everybody on the same page as far as understanding this threat is concerned. Let me just say a few other weaknesses which can be employed. Kurdish forces, as you know, next slide please. This slide? Yeah. Okay. Now please see this slide. In the year 2015, these areas in orange color are the ones which have been lost by ISIS. Look at their location, look at their size. And this light green is the area which they gained from Syrian armed forces. This is in the year 2015. This shows two, three things. One, that ISIS has lost the momentum. Despite the attack on Deir ez-Zor 3 days back, and overrunning of that arms depot in Al-Saika village and Ayash village north of Deir ez-Zor, I think they've lost momentum. Those are random kind of things that are happening. Syrian army hasn't made great gains, but for the first time, they are on the offensive. And the gains might follow. It has happened after 1 year. After President Bashar al-Assad himself made a statement 3-4 months back that the Syrian army is fatigued. Thereafter, now you see that they are attacking in Dara, they are attacking in Homs, Idlib, Latakia, and they have reached the Turkish frontier now. Of course, their whole idea is to make the area held by them more defensible, which can be held by lesser number of troops that are available to them now. They started off with 300,000 odd people and they are now left at about 170,000 people. So they can't hold the whole of Syria. So they want to make the battle lines defensible. So therefore, areas in between, they want to just get out of that place. I'll just finish it. ISIS is on the defensive. Syrian army has started getting on the offensive with the help of the, of course, Al-Quds and Hezbollah, undoubtedly, and with active support of the Russian armed forces. They have lost quite a bit of territory, and let me just show you the next slide, the last slide, which shows the area that has been lost or gained in the year 2015 by various elements there. If you see, the Syrian government has lost that area, but that's a vacant pocket, so to say, near Palmyra and Tadmur, that is. Of course, besides the historical sites and all that, area is no great strategic importance from the military point of view, or not even a population center or heartland of Syria, so to say. But the biggest gainers are the Kurds, because they are being supported, because they preserved their strength initially, and they came in at the right time, and they are being supported heavily. And they are supporting not only by America, but again, surprisingly, they are also being supported by Russia. And that's the biggest nightmare of Turkey. Let me just finish it off by saying what all can we do, and I'll just give them in point form. First, time is of a sense, let's do it quickly. Second, reconciling the the conflicting interests of various parties. Third, meet the grievances of the Sunni population in both the countries. I think we need to find a way to meet those grievances and recapture substantial territory from ISIL or ISIS. Air power will not be enough. So the ground troops, either you train and conscript more people from within Iraq and Syria, or the neighbors pitch in, but air power by itself is going to be a long drawn out affair and may not succeed. Establish clear priorities. You want Bashar's head or you want ISIS out? Be clear about that, because as far as Syria is concerned, I think the only force that can fight against ISIS today is still Bashar al-Assad's forces. Define the goal, dislodge ISIS from Iraq and Syria and restore the boundaries of these two states. So that was the objective that I had. Formation of a substantial multinational force, but mainly of the local people. And the second alternative, of course, is under the UN flag. And unity amongst allies is very important, and coordinated economic measures to starve out ISIS, I think it's important. This will go against the human rights issue. But let me just also tell you that human rights are important, we must take it, but I don't think we can send flowers to Baghdadi and listen to it. Something has to be done. And then, lastly, of course, and which is more long-lasting kind of a thing, is build a compelling, competing offer to its customers, or build up an alternative narrative to wean the people away from this ideology of hate. Thank you. Thank you very much.